Okay, so please take your Bibles. The Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Ephesians chapter 2. Please turn there. The message today is God's promises and our salvation. The principal theme of Scripture is the glory of God, His praise, His thanksgiving, His worship. He is the focus, He is the center, but He has also graciously provided for us salvation. And from the beneficial viewpoint, from the human viewpoint of what is good for us, that is, in terms of eternity, perhaps the most important topic in the Bible. Now, earlier I read that entire second chapter of Ephesians because it gives us the context for God's promises and our salvation, though the focus is on verses 8 through 10. As we look at that today, do you remember what we've read? We all know verses 8 and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith. It has all the big operative words, grace, saved, faith. And from that point forward, there are incredible purposes of God, incredible promises of God after we get past that verse. But don't forget the context. Look at the context. Don't forget where we started all of this journey. Verse 1, we started out dead, not alive, not sick, not dying. We started out dead. That's a pretty grim prognosis if you're hoping to be saved. But, of course, it's irrational to talk about dead men hoping to be saved because dead men don't even hope. So if hope is present, any hope has to be from the outside, just like any salvation has to be from the outside. You cannot save yourself. You cannot make choices apart from the sovereign will of God. Dead. That's what it says in verse 1, and you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins. Verse 2, let's see where else these dead runners in this race started out where the gun sounded. We started out in rebellion, it says. We started out in submission to the devil and his demonic forces. We started out in reveling in, enjoying and having fun with the putrid, rotting world that is all around us. It's not a very good place to start if you want to make any headway in the race of life. See, that's what it says in verse 2, wherein in time past we walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. There's the world and the devil. Huh, the spirit that now worketh in. Here's what we're walking with, the children of disobedience. Disobedience. We started out in rebellion. We didn't start out seeking God. There's none that seeks God, says the Apostle Paul in the book of Romans. There's none that does good. No, not one. That's where we started, folks. Not a very good place to start. If you want to have salvation and you think you're going to put something into the mix. Verse 3, but that's not all that this sorry batch of losers had against them at the starting line, and we're all part of that sorry batch of losers. Verse 3 says, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. What do we get out of that verse? Well, we find a few more things about this group that some of them are going to get saved, but certainly not because they're winners, because we're all losers. What else do we learn? Well, we're definitely hanging out with the wrong crowd. It talks about the children of disobedience that we're hanging out with. All of our actions were characterized by the lusts of the flesh. Lust, gluttony, pride, sloth, envy, greed, you name it. You know, we think we're so good before we're saved. We think that we've got it made, and, you know, on average, we're probably better than the average guy out there. You know what? We're all dead. We're all rotten. We're all polluted by the lusts, the gluttony, the pride, the sloth, the envy, the greed. It's all there. You know, and it says here, we didn't just think about it and talk about it, we did it. It says, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. We're not just thinking about it, we're doing it. That's where we started, dead in trespasses and sins. We'd gone across the boundary. We had sinned against the holy God. The wrath of God was upon us. Salvation is not of man. Salvation is of the Lord. That's why the promises concerning salvation are so precious. The great and precious promises that God makes to those of us who are lost, who are dead, who are sinners. Promises of salvation. We were a filthy bunch of decadent perverts before God saved us. The only nature we had was already under the judgment of God. Look at that phrase. By nature, the children of wrath. I hope you're getting the point. If you're sitting out there as a young person thinking you're pretty good and you're better than that guy over there, or better than that girl who's running around, or better than that guy who, you know, is pilfering stuff at the store and slipping into his pocket, you got another thought coming. Even as others, that means we're all in the same boat. I'm not better than you. You're not better than me. You're not better than your friends. You're not better than those people you look down your nose at. When we started out before salvation, we were all lost. You know, salvation implies something. It implies that you're in a dangerous position. And it implies that if you don't get out of that dangerous position, bad things will happen. You know, you read the newspapers and here's a little girl saved from falling into a deep pit. Boy saved from rabid dog. Drowning sailors saved at sea. Every one of them facing some crisis that is about to take their life, that is about to put them in a more difficult situation, that is about to harm them, that is about to destroy them. When we use the word saved, we use it too lightly, because when we're talking about salvation in Scripture, we're talking about being saved from multiple things. Two of the principal ones, we are being saved from hell, because without Christ, you're on your way to hell. Believe me, people, the Bible says it. I don't have to pull back on that. There is a real hell, a burning hell. It's an eternal hell, and it will burn you if you don't know Christ. And you will never get out, and there's not a drop of water there. Jesus said so in Luke chapter 16. And for all of eternity, you will burn. And you will burn, and you will burn, and you will not be consumed, where their worm dieth not. The fire is not quenched, and you're not consumed. You need to be saved if you're not. You need to understand, and only God the Holy Spirit can take the Word of God as we read it today and apply it to your heart. But if you're lost, you are on your way to hell. Second thing from which we are saved. And Paul talks about it, from the wrath to come. God is going to pour out his judgment upon this world. He did it in the days of Noah, and Peter talks about how he will do it again, and he's going to consume the earth with fire. He's going to send the judgments of the tribulation. Some incredible judgments that are coming along. And as we get to chapter 16, where we see the bold judgments, it says that men know that God is the one who's judging them, and instead of repenting, they shake their fist at God, they curse God, because he's the one who's sending the plagues. Even those judgments do not bring them to their knees. But someday, when they and Satan and all of his demonic host are cast into the lake of fire, it says, every knee shall bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The day is coming, folks. I don't care whether you're young or old. If you're not ready, you will burn. Understand it clearly. Because your life depends on it. Verse 3. The sorry losers on the starting line. The only nature we had was already under the judgment of God. By nature, the children of wrath. And we were no different than anybody else. It says, even as others. We may have thought we were better, but we were groveling in psychotic self-delusion if we thought that we were better than someone else. Can I be blunt for a moment? You say you just were. Okay, let me be more blunt. When you're unsaved, in the eyes of God, you are really filthy bad. You stink. You reek. Isaiah says that your very best, your righteousness, smells like filthy rags. Isaiah 64:6. But we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. Hold on. The word picture that Isaiah is giving is the picture of a rotting, menstruous cloth that shows conception has not taken place by the seed of the Word of God. That's the filthy rags. That's the proof that conception has not taken place. Without Christ, you are rotten and you stink in the nostrils of God. When you see, for example, a rotting body covered with rotting blood and flies, it's enough to make you throw up. I've seen, and I'm sure that many of you have also seen, the rotting, blood-soaked dead bodies of animals. I lived in Alabama, saw a lot of roadkill. I ran out on the country roads and it was all over the place. How much worse the rotting, blood-soaked dead body of a human being. Some of my friends had to see that in Vietnam. You know, it's not a very good place for a dead man to start trying to come alive if he has to do it by himself. See the rotting body? See the flies? Okay, come alive. It won't happen. That's where you started, folks. Without Christ, that's where you started. Absolutely impossible. Spiritual conception. As in physical life, so in spiritual life. The seed joins the egg and suddenly new life has been conceived. But self-righteousness that Isaiah describes proves that no conception has taken place in the heart by the entry of the living Word of God. Let's look at the next verse, verse 4. It's only after God has set the stage showing how really bad we are that then he shows us his grace and his promises concerning salvation. Verse 4 has two small words that make all the difference in the world. The first two words. But God. Here's all this bad stuff. This is who we were. This is what we are without Christ. And that's how God looks at us. And we're no different than anybody else, no matter how much education we have, no matter how much money we have, no matter how many friends we have, no matter how many times we've gone to church, that's how God sees us. We can't come alive by ourselves, but God. Oh, magnificent words. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. That knocks me over. Why? Why would he love me? Why would he love you? Can you think of one good reason when you see yourself as verses 1 through 3 point out? Can you think of one good reason why God should love you? There are none. There are none! This verse tells us some very incredible things about God. First, it tells us about God's mercy. But God, who is rich in mercy. He said, well, it doesn't tell me much. Well, it tells you a lot. Let me just give you some contrast to start off with. Mercy is not the same thing as grace. Let me give you a way that you can remember the difference between mercy and grace. Now, this is very basic. Even a kindergartner will understand this. Mercy starts with M, and grace starts with G. Have we all got that? If you got that, raise your hand, please. Okay, you're with me, all right. So what? All right, it helps you remember something. G. God extends his grace to us as we are guilty. Remember, GG, grace, guilty. God extends his grace to us as we are guilty. Now let's get the M&Ms. God extends his mercy to us as we are miserable. What's the difference? Grace, guilty. Mercy, miserable. You see, sin brings guilt to our consciences. That's where we start. Sin brings guilt to our consciences. That can only be remedied by the blood of Christ. You know, the blood of Christ not only takes care of your sins, where you get your sins forgiven, the blood of Christ will also cleanse your conscience. That's what it says in Hebrews 9:14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, now listen to these words, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. You see, when your sins are not forgiven, you've got this horrible guilt in your conscience. And the devil likes to have you have that guilt in your conscience. Because every time you try to go serve God, maybe you're saved now, but the devil keeps reminding you, you remember that time that you were out on that date? And you shrink back from service. How could God use somebody like me? Or what if somebody else found out and they'd say, I'm a hypocrite? Do you remember that time when you slipped some answers to one of those other kids in class? What if they tell on you? Or what if some other kid saw it and he gets jealous and he tells on you? And it's always there. The blood of Jesus Christ not only cleanses us from all sin, but here, as you allow God, through the Spirit of God, working in your life, he will cleanse your conscience from dead works. All that stuff that you did, some of it you thought was good. You were helping a friend, for example. Or you were really loving that boy or really loving that girl. You might have even thought, in the stupid, sinful mindset that so many of us have, that what you were doing was pretty good. And then you begin to feel guilty about it. Oh, your conscience is tormenting you. Or maybe that time that you were out riding around, joyriding in a car, and you took a steel pole and you're riding by, they do this kind of stuff down south, I don't know if they do it up here, riding by mailboxes that are out on the curb and whacking every one of the mailboxes as you go by. Hope I didn't give anybody ideas. Right now, as I'm pausing here, you're thinking about things that you know you've had some guilt about. That's what sin does. It pollutes you. It wounds your conscience. Maybe something you did to somebody else. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Paul remembered what he had done when he stood and held the coats of those who stoned Stephen. Saul remembered how he had voted in the Sanhedrin. A special word is used there for casting a ballot. When believers were sentenced to death, it humbled him. It might even have kept him from being a servant of Christ. But he said, that stuff is under the blood of Jesus Christ. I've repented of it. And now with all of my heart, I will serve him. And as God told Ananias, as the Lord Jesus told Ananias, I will show him how great things he must suffer for my sake. Are you letting the blood of Christ cleanse your conscience? Are you daily washing with the water of the Word of God so that the Spirit of God can take the Word of God and cleanse your conscience so that you can serve? Did you look at the front of the bulletin today? I don't know where mine went, but here it is. Whom shall I send? Who will go for me? Isaiah responds, here am I, Lord. Send me. Do you know how Isaiah first had to see himself? Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. He sees Jesus. That's according to John chapter 12, that the one of whom Isaiah spake was Jesus. He saw the Lord Jesus Christ high in the temple, lifted up, smoke filling the temple, the seraphim running around him saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is full of the Lord's glory. And what did Isaiah say? Woe is me, for I am undone. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. An angel took tongs and a coal from off the altar and put it on his lips and cleansed him. Young people, God can use you. It's not an excuse for you to continue in sin. What? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? It's not an excuse for continuing in sin just because you have forgiveness. But the blood of Jesus Christ can cleanse your conscience too from dead works to serve the living God. Whom shall I send? Who will go for me? Is there someone here who will say, here am I. Send me. He can use you. If you're saved, he can use you. Grace extends to us as we are guilty. Mercy as we are miserable. Guilt in our consciences can be cleansed. Sin brings misery also into our existence. Not merely the guilt that grace deals with, but the misery of our existence is what God extends his mercy to. The conditions in which we live because of our stupid choices and sinful lifestyles. Did you know that every choice you make has consequences? There's no exception. Every choice, even the so-called little choices you make, every choice you make has consequences. You decide to go back to the house because you forgot something. And perhaps you won't know until eternity, but by doing that, and then you got into your car and drove, you missed having a fatal accident. Little choices. Not a sparrow falls without your father. It doesn't say without your father's knowledge, it says without your father. The very hairs of your head are numbered. Do you not think that your day-by-day choices have consequences? If God counts the hairs on your head, and if God is the one who determines even the day of death for a sparrow, mercy comes to us when we are miserable because of our stupid choices and our sinful lifestyles. The verse also tells us that God is very rich when it comes to mercy. He's not a miser. When he extends mercy to you in your misery because of your sin, he's not a miser about it. In fact, God is generous with all kinds of things. Generous with grace, generous with love, generous with mercy, generous with wisdom. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who upbraideth not. He won't bawl you out for asking. and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is as a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For that think, let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. When you ask for wisdom, you have to ask in faith. If you don't, not only will you not get wisdom, you won't get anything else. Let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Do you flip-flop on issues? You make up your mind to do this, and then you decide, no, I don't think I'll do that. So you make up your mind to do this, no, I don't think I'll do that. Then you flip back over to here. Then you, oh, there's a third choice over here. And you can never get it down. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Ask for wisdom in faith, and God will direct your paths. Second, this verse tells us about God's love. These are all things related to God's salvation, you know. That's the context of this passage. What does it tell us about God's love? Well, first, it tells us God's love is great. You know, it would have to be to encompass all of us. It would have to be great because all of us stink in the sight of God. We just talked about that. That's the first three verses. How could God love even one sinner like that? But you think of the thousands of people who have been saved over the years, and God, in his grace and love, has encompassed this stinking mass of humanity. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. God does a lot better than that. Emma Lazarus on the Statue of Liberty, but God does much better than that. The second thing we learn about God's love, the greatness of God is not merely a reference to his omnipotence. It's also a reference to his love. Isn't that incredible? For his great love wherewith he loved us. When we think of the greatness of God, we think about his omnipotence. But here it's tied to his love. The Muslim is always yelling, Allah Akbar, God is great. And all he thinks about is the power of God. Not about the character of God, just that he's big enough to beat you up if he wants to. But here the greatness of God is tied to his love. The third thing that we learn from this is that God's kind of love is a choice, not an emotion. You know, we were not very beautiful when God chose to love us. It wasn't a passionate, oh man, I can hardly believe how beautiful that girl is or that handsome guy. How good they are. Oh my, they are good. I must choose them. God did not look down the corridors of time and base his elective choices upon who would believe and who wouldn't believe. Because that makes God subject to history rather than making history subject to God. History is subject to God.
God did this to keep him humble.
God's kind of love is a choice.
There was given to me a thorn in the flesh. People have posited that perhaps that thorn in the flesh was the bad eye.
Fourth thing that we learn is love is not
a messenger of Satan
to
buffet me,
but
lest
a freely
I should be
given,
above measure.
Independent choice.
Now here's what I want to talk about.
Sometimes people are forced
your body
to do things against
the temple
their will
of the Holy Spirit.
But God's never forced to do anything against his will. His love is not a forced choice. It
because that makes God subject
given
to history rather than
it
making history subject to God.
Of all
history is subject to
because
God.
God owes us nothing.
God did this to keep him humble.
God's kind
there
of thing we learn. Love is based on the inner character of the lover,
not
on
the bad eyes.
Fourth thing that we learn is love is not
a messenger of Satan to buff
him, but a freely
exalted love.
When you're talking about the subject of love, because we have all kinds of human
passion. Now here's what I want to
sometimes
talk
about.
People are forced your body
to do God things says is
against the temple
will
of the Holy Spirit.
It's based on the inner
but
character
God's never
of
forced
the lover,
to do anything against
the
will.
One loved. Number
his
six,
love, is
love may be
choice
present even when the object of love is unlovely.
Because that makes God subject to history rather than making history subject to God. Have any of you ever known
history is subject to God?
God owes us nothing.
Had a
God did this to keep him humble. Maybe.
God's kind of thing we learn.
Love is based on the inner character of the lover,
not on the
bad eyes.
The fourth thing that we learn is love is not a
messenger of Satan to buff him, but a freely,
especially when you're talking about the subject of love, because we have all kinds of human
passions. Here's what I want to talk about.
Sometimes we can
force your body to do things against the temple of the Holy Spirit.
It begins to based on the inner character
of the lover,
to do anything
not the
beauty
of the
one loved. Number
his
six, love may be present
choice.
Even when the object of love is
unloved. Because that makes God subject to history, rather than making history subject to God.
Have any of you ever known
all history is subject to God.
God
owes us nothing.
Who had such a baby, born without part of its arm. And oh, how she loves that little girl. Don't confuse your hormones with the love God says you should have. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. When someone tells you they love you, go through that list. One good place to start is seeketh not her own. Is the reason they're saying they love you is because they want something from you. And you know what that usually is. Love may be present even when the object of love is unlovely. You know something else? Love is not based on age or talent or physical strength or money. Or accomplishments, or big muscles, or a nice body, or genetic heritage, or does he have a nice car, or the 101 other idiot things that teenagers base their carnal puppy love on. The love of God is a great love, and it is defined in 1 Corinthians 13. And if you study that passage, you will know whether or not someone else really loves you. Now let's see some of the great salvation promises that are tied to the greatness of God's mercy and love. There are at least 17 promises of God related to our salvation in this one chapter alone. I'm not even going to have time to go to all the other chapters. I got places all over the Bible for it, but just here. Number one, promised life. We were dead in sins and he made us alive. He didn't just embalm us. Did you get that? Oh, here's a dead body. What are we going to do with it? Well, got a dead body. Take it down to the undertaker. He embalms it. He makes it look nice. But it is still dead. God did not embalm us. When we were dead in sins, he made us alive. He's quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. Number two, the promise of life is the promise of resurrection life. It's alluded to by the words, hath quickened us together with Christ, plus the first phrase of verse 6. It says, and hath raised us up together. That is an allusion to resurrection. Number three, he has given us royal thrones with Jesus. That's in verse 6. God sees us all there, already there. He has made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Is that a pretty good promise attached to salvation? I think so. God already sees me, Ephesians chapter 1, in Christ. When he looks at me, he looks through the lens of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he says, there's Christian Spencer down there. And even though he's an imperfect human being, and I am a very imperfect human being, he sees me in Christ, in him, in the Beloved. I am in Christ. And I am seated with Christ in heavenly places, according to verse 6. He has already prepared for me a house, John 14. And he has made me to sit in heavenly places with Christ. Are these great and precious promises that are attached to salvation? I think so. If you know Jesus, they're true of you also. Number four, he has promised the permanence of this position as grace receivers by future promises of kindness to us. If you've trusted Christ, you're a grace receiver. And if you're a grace receiver, God has not only the promises which are now, the ones that you're experiencing, the things that get rid of all your sins that are past, God has future promises for you as well. Look at what it says here. Verse 7, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. God did not have to be kind to me nor did he have to be kind to you. And he certainly didn't have to be kind to us in the future. He could have said, okay, I'm going to save you. I'll keep you out of hell, but I'll sit you right on the edge where you'll watch it and you'll sweat bullets all through eternity wondering whether or not you're going to fall in. God didn't do that. In the ages to come, you go as far as you want, and God is still going to be showing kindness to you because he's a God of grace. I love that promise. You know, I know some people that are kind part of the time and not kind part of the time, and kind part of the time and not kind part of the time. And I don't have to worry about that fluctuation with God. He is always kind to those who are his children. Good example for us as parents. You know, sometimes I felt like murdering my kids as they were growing up. Praise God I didn't. I think they're pretty happy about that too. But I wasn't always kind. Although I tell you, that was one of my focuses. That was one of my goals, to be kind. Why? Because I'm supposed to reflect the Heavenly Father as the Father of my children. I'm supposed to show the character of Jesus Christ to my children. Some of you are going to get married someday. And when you do, you will have differences with your husband or wife. And you will definitely have differences with your children. The question is, will you always treat them with kindness? You are the boss. You're in charge. But there are different ways to be in charge. Remember how our Heavenly Father treats us. The promises of the future kindness as well as present kindness. And of course, number 5, he's promised salvation by grace through faith. We could spend a long time unpacking that one, and we have many more to go, so I'll move on. You've all heard sermons on Ephesians 2:8. Number 6, he's promised that we don't have to earn salvation, not of works, lest any man should boast. He is number 7, he's promised to do all the work of salvation, for we are his workmanship. You don't have to do any of the work of salvation. Isn't that nice? Most world religions say, well, God has part of it, but you have part of it too. You're the one who has to do part of it. And so you got people crawling to Rome on their knees and over broken glass and kissing the cross that's embedded in the Scala Sancta, the holy staircase that theoretically is where Jesus climbed up the stairs, and, you know, kissing the Pope's toe and all that kind of stuff. You don't have to do that for salvation. You don't have to light candles. You don't have to go to masses. Jesus paid it all. He paid it all. What a great promise. That you won't get to heaven and God said, oop, I go down the list and you did pretty well, but you missed number 17. Oh, down here you missed number 79. Oh, here you missed number 2,742. Jesus paid it all. That's one of the greatest promises of salvation. I love it. Number 8, he has promised our position in Christ. He hath created us in Christ Jesus. Number 9, he has promised the results of our salvation unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. If they don't show up, you might want to question your salvation. You don't get saved by works, but if you are saved, it says God has before ordained, he has predestined that you, as one of his children, will do certain things that are good works. Now, good works are not just helping little old ladies across the street or donating and throwing money in at Christmas time to one of those pots where the Salvation Army guy is ringing his bell. That's not good works. Good works, the test for good works, Number 1, it has to be to the glory of God. If it's not for the glory of God, it's not a good work. Do all to the glory of God, says the Apostle Paul. So if it's not to the glory of God, if it's to your glory or to the glory of somebody else, it is not a good work. Number 2, it has to be done in the power of the Holy Spirit. If you're doing it in the power of the flesh, it is not a good work. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, says Paul, dwelleth no good thing. So if you are not doing it in the power of the Holy Spirit, you are not doing a good work. Number 3, It must be done in obedience to the Word of God. Obedience to the Word of God. If it is disobedient to the Word of God, it is not a good work, no matter how good it looks. Those are the tests that the Bible gives for what are good works. God has foreordained good works that you will do, that I will do, that we would walk in them, not just kick one of them every now and then. Walking means you are moving forward. We're to walk by faith. We're to walk in the Spirit. We're to walk in good works because God has before ordained that we should walk in them. It's guaranteed for one who is a believer, for one who has been irresistibly drawn by the grace of God, who is chosen in Christ in eternity past, one who has been predestined to good works, that we should walk in them. If they're not showing up in your life, examine yourself, says the Apostle Paul, to see whether or not you be in the faith or whether you be reprobate. I'm running out of time. He's promised that result of our salvation. Number 10, he's promised the distinct separation that comes with our salvation. Verses 11 and 12. Wherefore, remember that ye, being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision, that was a derogatory term, by that which is called the circumcision, that's the Jews in the flesh, made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. In Christ, we're all one, Jews and Gentiles, bond and free, male and female. It doesn't mean that males have become females. That's this transgender junk of today. You know, it doesn't mean that the slaves suddenly were free and they could run away from their masters. Paul sent Onesimus back. It doesn't mean that Israel is a church. It means that now we are one in Christ. It's composed of Russians and Chinese, even if you don't like either one of them. It's composed of Indonesians. It's composed of South Americans. It's composed of some people who used to be headhunters. It's composed of some who used to be Orthodox Jews, Dati'im. It's composed of Canadians and Mexicans. And yes, even some of us nasty Americans. The distinct separation that comes with our salvation, we've been brought together. Verse 13, but now in Christ, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. He's promised the peace of our salvation. Number 12, for he is our peace who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Number 13, he's abolished the hatred between Jew and Gentile by our salvation. Verse 15, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of the commandments contained in ordinances, referring to the Old Testament law, for to make of himself in twain one new man, so making peace. Number 14, he's provided the means of reconciliation through our salvation, that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you. That's what reconciliation is all about, peace with God. That God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, and hath committed unto us, we're distinct from the world, hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. It's our job, you have been called to go and preach the gospel of reconciliation, that Christ, through the blood of the cross, has made reconciliation. There are still those who are at war, still those who are fighting, but the war is over. Jesus won. He won it at the cross and the empty tomb. The war is won. And there are still those who are in rebellion. He's provided the Holy Spirit. What a great promise. And through this, he has provided access to the Father with our salvation. Look here. Verse 18, for through him, that is through Jesus, we both have access by one Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, unto the Father. What an incredible blessing that comes with salvation. What a fantastic promise that we now have access to God. The veil of the temple has been rent in twain. We do not have to have a high priest who goes in once a year on Yom Kippur, on the Day of Atonement, and sprinkles the blood on the mercy seat, because Jesus Christ is our hilasterion. He is our mercy seat, according to the book of Hebrews. His blood has been shed and spilled on the mercy seat. He is our great high priest. The veil is rent. We have direct access to the Father by the Spirit of God for those who are saved. There are all kinds of people out there making prayers, and they don't even hit the ceiling. The only one whose prayers goes through because he has the great high priest, Jesus Christ, whose blood has been shed and sprinkled on the mercy seat, is the one who is saved. There are a lot of reasons why prayers don't get answered, but one of the chief reasons is people are not saved. Are you saved? Do you know you're saved? Do you have the salvation of which we speak? The great and precious promises of God that are joined to salvation in such a way they can never be pulled apart. Indissolvably joined. Oh yes, there's so much more here. Number 16, he has made us heavenly citizens and family members. Verse 19, now therefore you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. You're a fellow citizen and you're part of a household. That's one of the great promises of salvation. You are not a citizen of earth. You're just a pilgrim. You're just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. The old Negro spiritual understood it. We are fellow citizens of heaven. That's where your true allegiance is. Though I love my country, my allegiance is to heaven. I hope yours is. And not only are we fellow citizens, but we are part of God's household. The book of Ephesians is the only place where the word family is used in the New Testament, speaking of our relationship to the Heavenly Father. Number 17, he has made us part of the same structure as the apostles and prophets, part of his holy temple. For his promise is to live in us and abide in us. And Paul has much to say about that, where he's talking about your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Don't you realize that when you take the temple of the Holy Spirit and join it to a harlot, and you're one flesh with that person, that you're defiling the temple of God, and the person who defiles the temple of God, him will God destroy, it says. Because the temple of God is holy. Which temple ye are? If you're saved, you're part of the temple of God. It says so right here. Look at verses 20 through 22. And are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ, himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together. I've done a lot of building. I know what this is about. Fitly framed together. Groweth into an holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together. For an habitation of God through the Spirit. God's promises in our salvation. Those are great and precious promises. I have much more, but that's what takes us through Ephesians chapter 2. And we'll leave it there. But remember, salvation is salvation from something. First and foremost, it's salvation from hell. It's salvation from wrath to come. It's salvation from the control of Satan, the god of this world, who's blinded the minds of them that are lost, lest they should believe and obey the gospel of Christ. Are you saved? Are you saved? Are you saved? Dear young people, I love you. And that's why I tremble. Because someday some of you may stand before the Lord Jesus. And you've played church. Matthew 7. And he will say, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. I don't know you. Are you saved? Trust Jesus. He died for you. He was buried. He rose again, literally and bodily. And if you place your faith in him alone, he gives you the gift of eternal life. Gracious Father, thank you for your word and for its power. You've promised that your word will not return void, but that it will accomplish that which you please, and it will prosper in the thing whereto you have sent it. I pray that you have sent it this day into the hearts of these young people. to transform their lives, those who are not saved to trust Christ, those who are saved. When the question is asked, whom shall I send and who will go for us? They will respond, here am I, Lord. Send me. In Jesus' name, amen.